Guru Kripa Kevalam. Namaste and welcome everyone to Satsang today. Sadhguru Shimoji Baba Ki Jai. If you need to call on, can we hear Kripa, Kripa Dholakia? You come, my dear.
Namaste.
Namaste. Namaste. Is there something you want to say? Or?
Not particularly. Just
tell me anything.
Full of gratitude.
Sorry to put you on a spot like this. I'm sure it was completely unexpected.
That's okay. Thank you.
Is there a present contemplation or a question that you feel like you are contemplating deeply in your heart?
What comes up is this, the contemplation or the awareness of wanting to always come back home and just constantly recentering.
Yes.
To be in that place.
Yes.
And listening to some of the past satsangs, you speak of this place of being in God's light and there is this doubt that I see where when there's awareness, there's this questioning of, oh, is this the correct place? but typically, what happens is there's this movement back into the awareness of seeing that questioning and sort of this. That's typically where I think the work or the exercise happens.
Yes. Very good. Thank you. Thank you for starting in this way. Let's explore the term awareness a little more deeply. So when we say that there is awareness, are we saying that there is awareness or are we saying that it is apparent that I am this awareness? Is there a difference in the two?
Yes. It seems as though there is an awareness and there is another layer behind that, because it seems as though when there is awareness, the first level of it is one where there can be judgment can be seen. So there can be this association of an evaluating quality to it. But then there's also a different, if there's a further back position, it's watching of that. And then at some point, there is this place of awareness is who I am.
Yes.
But there's this movement that goes in and out, which is what I try to just contemplate on and watch and see.
Yes.
As a watcher, or what is being watched.
Right. So let's start satsang here today from the highest, and then to look at how it seems to be operating. So when you check whether you are aware or not, can you ever make the discovery that there is awareness without it being apparent that I am this awareness? It sounded a bit long, so let me repeat. So we can check, am I aware? And it's very natural for most of us to now confirm that there is awareness. Now, can there ever be a discovery of this awareness without it including very clearly that it is apparent that I am this awareness? So not only am I aware, I am this awareness. Can that be taken away? Is it two different parts? And we'll come to what the oscillation can seem like in a moment. But just trying to clarify for everyone, I'm asking whether it is a discovery that you are making about something. So I saw that the tree is green, or I saw that the room is big, or I saw the fruit is yellow. Is it that kind of discovery? Or in the discovery, is it apparent that I am itself what is being discovered? Or is there an additional step in it?
There is that discovery that I am being discovered.
Yes, that this awareness is my own self, my true self. You see, it is included in that, whether we think that or no. Let's first meet here, everyone. And if anyone struggles with this, please point that out. And then we'll look at the mechanics of what happens when the manifestation shows up. Can we start by cutting straight to this? It seems absurd because it seems like this is the finality discovered at the end. But maybe today, satsang, we can start this way. Are you aware? So this awareness, is it something that you are discovering, or you are it? Is it a discovery like there is a cloth? Ah, I see the cloth. You see, maybe it was like this. I say, okay, turn to your right, there is a cloth. Ah, there's a cloth. But it isn't me. There is a cloth. You see? But is this discovery of a... the right answer? Check for yourself. But as you check, am I aware? That awareness that you find, you see that it is you itself. It's a very strange discovery. It's very strange. All aboard? Clear? Now, as this is apparent, now what happens? It is apparent to you that there is a qualitative functioning of yourself, which is functioning as beingness or I amness. That you exist strangely, because in the world it can sound again very absurd. That you exist is not inherent in your absolute nature. See if we can meet this. But this is very confusing to the mind. In the world, if something is real, if it is true, it must exist. Isn't it? But in your reality, even existence or non-existence comes later. Let me see this in you, and then we'll peel it up a bit to see whether we can meet this. You see? So in the world's idea, the beingness of something or the not beingness of something is inherent to it, its reality. It either exists or it doesn't exist. But in your reality, you are beyond being and not being. So as you're meeting yourself as pure awareness, and I use that word provisionally, pure, it continues to be by itself empty of being or not being. Don't make this academic. I want this to be your lived experience. Because that awareness which you are finding, you cannot say about it that it exists or it doesn't exist. Even to say that it is like a, you have to stretch the word. It is beyond the boundaries of existence and non-existence, and therefore completely unfathomable to our mind, because we've already stretched our mind too far to even just come to this. Because the mind will say, but it is, if I am awareness, then I am. But I'm saying you are awareness before you are. Too much? You can hold back on it if you want. Okay, let me expand a bit and then see if it's getting too complex. As you are awareness, you notice that there is a sense of being. There is a being which carries the vibration of amness. Therefore, we say, I am. I exist. So when I say to you, can you stop being? Hopefully this existence comes into focus. So many times I've asked, what is the difference in the two questions? Am I aware now? And can I stop being? You can check on this. So that which you truly are is beyond all duality, even the duality of the primal being on and not being. But because it is so beyond human understanding and perceptual knowledge, doesn't mean that it is inaccessible to us. Because it is our very nature. And therefore it is most obvious to us. Everything else is lesser obvious. It may sound strange. The truth about yourself is most obvious to you. But because we have trained ourselves in that which is lesser obvious and we have trained ourselves to work to understand, therefore this seems more difficult. And we don't value that which we don't have to work to understand. So we feel like this is, I'm not finding anything, we can keep doubting. This reality is the most obvious. Without any work, you know it. When you start working, you start getting hypnotized by the mind of it. So it seems to lose. You seem to lose it. And seem to is the emphasis there. So would it be too radical of us to say that the discovery of the absolute, the highest, is the most simple, most obvious, and most apparent to us, unless we want it to mean something to us? The instant we attach any meaning that it must have to me, then it gets all contaminated. Not in reality, but our insight seems to get contaminated. And quickly the mind will come with its selfishness saying, okay, now, so then, if it is that simple, what does it mean? And we'll come to that in a moment. I'm just making you aware of this kind of mind trick. So we saw that there is awareness. It is apparent. In that insight, it is clear that I am it. It is not two separate insights. It is not that first you saw that there is awareness and then you saw, hey, by the way, that is me. It was included already. You cannot have an insight about awareness without the insight that it is you. It's not two separate steps. You see it as your very nature, your very reality. It is so obvious and simple. Then you are also noticing, and we'll talk about the tools, but I feel you are following. You are also noticing that not only are you aware, you are also being. Doesn't mean that now there are two. See, the I itself. If you are awake, if you are dreaming, does that mean that there are two of you? You're either awake or asleep or you're dreaming, but there's still one of you. In the same way, independent of being or not being, there is only one of you. I. So this being does not feel like to anyone the being of somebody else. When this being is recognized, we say, I am. See? I am, not you are. We're speaking very subtle things, but very simple. Don't let your mind say this is difficult. This is very simple. Just if you are fully simple, this will be very obvious to you. So you are aware, and at the moment, you are also being. You are also being. Now, in the existence of this being, there is all the play of the universe, the appearance of the universe, the world, of time, of space. And it's so intricately made, so beautifully designed. It's like a beautiful painting that if you look at the painting deeply enough, you see, and you believe the within the painting, what is being said about the painting, quickly you can take this to be the reality. The painting which is just showing up in the light and on the screen of your very being also includes, like in the beginning of a movie, many times there's a narrator speaking, explaining everything to you. So in the painting is also included the narrator, the narrative. So if you stare at the painting and you believe what the narrator is saying, very quickly what we discovered first seems to be forgotten. And you take yourself to be what? A body mind. So this, but it is still the same I am. So the I, as I am, then presenting the universe within which the narrator is proposing that I am something. That I am something. And this narrator carries the power of great hypnosis. It's a great magician, great hypnotizer. You say, this is what happened to you. This is what you want in life. This is what gives you meaning. This is all the desires, aversions, all the plans, ambitions, all the regrets, the guilts, the prides, everything is the hypnosis of the narrator, which is available only in the projected. When the projected is there, then it takes the perceptions of that, which by themselves are actually innocent. So if you look at the painting without a narrator, you can enjoy it. You've gone to a museum where there's a full wall, a painting is a full wall, and you keep looking at it. You enjoy it for as long as you want. There's no trouble. But if you were wearing those museum headsets, and suppose the headset was buggy, and it said, you are in this painting, this character there, you see, by the way, is you. This is what happened to you. And you listen to it for a while, it'll start seeing real. You'll forget that you're witnessing from the quote-unquote outside, and you feel that you're within that. And this is what is called the Maya. This is called Maya. So now that you, which is awareness, pure awareness, untouched by any of this, you see, is being. And within that being, it is creating a multitude of these plays, these narratives, these universes, you see? And with our attention, we are perceiving a particular play of time and space, and within the perception of that is also the narrative that I am something that is included in this play. And that is called ego or identification. What has happened to you in reality? Nothing has happened to you. See, nothing has happened to you. See? So, the only way in which we can play as if we are a body mind is under the hypnosis of the mind. And the hypnosis of the mind is a two-step process. The first step is to give it attention, to give the thought attention, and the second step is to exert or apply the power of belief. Without both these happening, not either, but both, without both these happening, you cannot be hypnotized. And what happens when you are hypnotized? It seems like you are not awareness and you are not being, but you are this body-mind entity. Is it? But we must not be super quick to say it seems like. When we are still in the seeming, we should not jump within the same seeming to say it seems like. We must first return to the apparency, and then if the words come from there, then we can say this is a lila. Because the hypnotizer itself will use this itself to keep you in the hypnosis. Oh, all of this is a big seeming. It all seems real. You see? But the fragrance is not there. The fragrance is not there many times. So then you can, as long as it, the seeming is not just any other seeming. It is not something where a worldly parallel we can draw yet, although with virtual reality and things we are getting close. But the seeming is so deeply, intricately designed that while the seeming is taken to be the truth, it seems completely true. It feels completely true. So don't discount the power of Maya till you're out of it. So then what happens? Now suppose that this being separated itself just provisionally. Okay, so just to elaborate on this, separated itself into trillions and trillions and trillions of body-mind organisms. And each of them, as they retain the power of consciousness, could take themselves to be what they really are. Or could be within the hypnosis and therefore take themselves to be the body-mind. None of this, what I'm saying, is true. But for a while, it does seem like that. So when it seems like that, then also God or the Self in its grace, in its love, has given us a exit door. Within the painting, there's a small seeming exit door. See? Which is impossible to do actually for any, like no painter in the world can create an exit door over there saying, with this you will free yourself from the hypnosis of the painting itself. You see? Because the objective universe has really nothing to do with the attributeless nirguna reality of what we are. But because of the magnificence of the Self, within this itself, there is created a way out of the hypnosis. And what is that exit door? That exit door is God's presence or the presence of this being itself, which can be met even in this world. It's the most otherworldly or out of the worldly thing, quote unquote, thing that we can meet. But it is possible to meet. God's presence is possible to meet. That is the good news. That is the good news. And I'm sharing the good news as Christmas is coming and we have a Christmas party also just after this. So this is the good news. This is the good news. That even for those who are deeply under the hypnosis of the Leela, of this Maya, it is not hopeless. Because there is something here which can be met, which can take us to the vast reality which is beyond human conceptualization or visualization or perception. So that presence, we can give it many names. We can call it the Sadguru. We can call it God's light. We can call it the presence of beingness. We can call it presence itself. We can call it the Holy Spirit, like we just heard in the beautiful song when we started satsang. But as you come into, let's say, contact with this, then you realize that actually, because it is a part of being itself, it is the very light of creation. It is the very screen on which creation happens. And it is the same light which is creating all of this, which is, can also guide us to our reality. And it is so simple to find. It is so simple to find. We can simply ask, in which light am I looking at the light of the world? In whose light are the lights in this room seen? If that light of your presence was not here, you could not experience anything. In whose light are these words being heard? In whose presence? But even simpler than that, maybe, is just to notice that there is a presence within me. Undeniably, we say, I am present. Even in classrooms, our teachers say, they'll call out a name, we say, present. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we say, are you sleeping? They say, no, Father, I'm present. Yeah. So, present. Whose presence are you talking about? This presence is palpable. You may have a condition where you're no longer able to feel your body, maybe for a few minutes. You can't feel your body, like you can't feel your skin or any sensations. And still you may say, I am present. You may lose your senses one by one. Sight may go, hearing may go, smell may go, touch may go, taste may go. With which of the senses did you go? You're still here. And even when the last sense was not perceivable, you say, but I am. In the light of this, so it's so beautiful, it is the creative light, the sustaining light of this universe, and the regenerative light when it's hiding us. but it's also the guide. It is the Sadguru itself. It is this very light of whom all the forms that we call master or sage, what are they? They are nothing but instruments to this light. And all of us are instruments to this light. So why do we say they are instruments to this light? Because they are predominantly away from the hypnosis of the false. They are predominantly away from the hypnosis of the false. And that is why we revere and we devote them, because they show us the way. Because that's where we want to get to. So because they show us the way in that way, that is why they deserve our reverence. So, that which creates the world, if that is available to us to guide us, but there is also the voice of individuality in our head, the voice of selfishness which wants to say me first and me alone. Is it? Even rationally speaking, which is the better voice to follow? Voice of the heart, the voice of the light, the voice of the presence. Isn't it? So, to follow that is to follow God's will. To be obedient to that is to be a good disciple of the Sadguru presence. That's all. But to follow the way of the head, which the main mantra of that one is, what's in it for me? That's the Maha Mantra of the mind, what's in it for me? And secondary corollary is, me first and me alone. So, that doesn't create the world. That, the only job of that hypnotizer is to make the, when the character appears, make the player believe that it is the character. Just like you put on a computer game and the character appears in that game, there must be a narrative along with that in some way, telling you this is your mission, this is what you have to do, so that you buy into the story. That's exactly what is happening here. So, to make you believe that you are that individual is the only job of this hypnotizer. But what has happened is that it has convinced us that our best interest lies in living on our own terms. Convinced us that its terms are our terms and our best interest is in living on those terms. Convinced us that it is valuable only if I can have my way. Not God's will. Because although everything I've said so far, you were all able to follow. And you may even agree with, even with rationality, when push comes to shove, where most of us get stuck. And that is the difficult part about being a spiritual seeker, because most in the world who are not spiritual seekers or come to satsang in any form, they feel like there's only one way, which is my way, the mind's way. They feel that they have no access to any other will. But you do. But you do. And if you were honest to yourself, you would notice that you want God's will to be subservient to your mind's way. What do I mean? Who defines the boundary? Does the heart define the boundary? All of us have a boundary. We say, I will follow, but not there. Yeah. Don't go there. Yeah. That's where my sweeties are, my chocolates, my attachments. Don't go there. Tell me about good things. Tell me about how I can find peace. Yeah. But the minute you go after my sweeties, I am out. You see? So then we create a boundary around which God can decide. When I come to satsang, I'm all yours. You see? But after I leave, you see? Leave me alone. We say it leaves us outside satsang. It leaves us outside satsang, but it's worth really looking at. It doesn't leave you really. So if the boundary maker is the head and it defines the extent of your trust and your devotion, and within that boundary God must operate, then who are we taking to be the higher one? So this tendency is what I'm calling fake spirituality. This tendency is a very convenient sort of spirituality. But we don't realize that it is actually may seem convenient, but actually continues our hypnosis. And the hypnosis is nothing but an attempt to make the hellish life of suffering seem comfortable. It is meant to convince you that the hell of pride and remorse and guilt and regret and birth and death and yesterday and tomorrow and good and bad and right and wrong and decisions and good decisions and bad decisions and outcomes and causes. It is designed to convince you that this hellish living is actually the right way to live. Nothing can be further from the truth. The true way to live is to live in the presence of God. And living in the presence of God, you naturally follow God's will. So when I ask you, are you living in God's light? This is what I'm saying. You cannot live in God's light and follow your will, can you? Try to do that. Okay, light. Yeah, can't do it. So, you may try to juggle for a bit. I say, hey, God is here. It may even extend and slap. Oh God, God. So like that we go along for some time, feeling like it is a medicine for suffering that I can take some dosage of. But this is the medicine which half taken is going to cause more trouble. So if you came to spirituality because you had an upset stomach, but you took half surrender, you seem to worsen your condition till you take the full dosage. And the thing is, now you've taken the dosage, you can't even go back. So you are stuck. You are stuck. Now that you've taken half dosage, you can't even say, okay, now how to stop. You can't stop. So now the only thing that will help is the full dosage. You have to complete the course of these antibiotics. Otherwise, they are more troublesome. So that is what is happening. So there is a phase in which we seem to oscillate, because we are in the middle of the dosage. And for a while, especially when we are tantrumy in satsang, it can feel like, I am worse off now than I was when I started with you. I'm worse off now, of course. Because you're midway through the remedy. So, you have to take the full dosage. The full dosage means that I am living fully in God's light, and when I'm not, I return fully to God's light. I'm not living. That seems exciting, actually. Nobody minds that. Living in God's light sounds beautiful. But the second part, which is included in that, which is that you can no longer live on your terms, that seems scary. So we may want to live in the beauty of God's light, but on my terms. But it's a package deal. You can't have just one without the other. In fact, God's light is not separate from God's will. So surrender, not the convoluted idea of surrender which the mind tells us, but true surrender is the openness to live on God's terms, come what may. Not on my terms, on God's terms. The two prompts will always be available to us. The two voices will always be available to us. In fact, the voice of the head will rush, will speak first, will shout, will try to get all your attention first. And that is our habit anyway. You see? So it will be available to us. But now you're catching the scent, the perfume of your heart, the perfume of God's light, in which the truth of this world and yourself are instantly apparent. Also, you will start to notice that even the world can only be enjoyed in God's light. I've seen these people who are like, who have everything that the mind may want. The richest person in the world. They have the best houses and live on private beaches and they do all of that stuff. When you see them, they don't look happy. They don't look happy. They don't have the shine on their face. Their eyes are not glistening. They look like a zombie, actually. Versus poor beggar on the street. Just be content in their heart, living in God's presence. And in a moment, you see their face. You may see so much light. You may see a big smile. You may see such a beautiful presence, a beautiful light emanating. I'm not drawing a parallel at all between richness and freedom. I'm just giving an example that the mind's objectives of where this light should go don't anywhere lead us into having a full life. If you had everything the mind wanted, but you were following everything that the mind was saying, and you had no darshan of this light within yourself, you had no experience of this presence, although it would continue to animate your life, of course, would you call that living? I lived like that for many years. Before I came to Guruji, I lived like that for many years. I don't call that a life. It was just mental slavery. I tried to do the right thing even then. But right and wrong were defined here. And no matter what I did, I always felt like something is missing. Something is not real. Something is missing. This can't be it. So that is not a life at all. Now I find that the beauty of this presence, that the only way to determine what is right and what is wrong and what should be done and what should not be done is whether it is coming from God or not. And when I say coming from God, I mean God uncontaminated by the mind. So now there is no concern about the outcome because it came from God. Who can understand the outcomes of something may happen 20,000 years later. There is no way that we can understand. Just like someone that seemed like a man was put on a cross about 2,000 years before. So looking at the scene right then, it would make no sense to them. Is this God's will? But you're tasting the fruit of God's will even to this day. That there are more Christians now in the world than the whole population was then. So it is not understandable to our limited intellect. And all the human ways of figuring out the right way to live and right and wrong and good and bad have been a complete mess anyway. So this is called faith, to trust God's presence so much that you bet your life on it, that you say whatever good is from there, I follow it unwaveringly, and when I'm not able to follow it unwaveringly, I bring it to the same light saying that this is where I have a fear, it stops me. So this is the true guide, not just on spiritual matters, but on everything. Because it is that which creates everything. It is also the great rejuvenator, the healer of everything. And we recognize this, even people in the world recognize this. When they say, oh, I want to take a break, I've had enough. And they say, okay, why do you want to go to the mountains? So I can be alone. I can be by myself, untroubled by all this. But what are they really yearning for? They're yearning to be with the presence. Because you could go to the mountain, and if you're just meditating on your head in the mountain, it is not going to make you happy. So many of us come back from vacation wanting a vacation from the vacation. Isn't it? Haven't we had that experience? It is not just physical tiredness, but it's also that we did not take a vacation from that which the vacation was needed. But the true rejuvenation is possible in the presence of God, in the presence of your being. So, let me make it simpler. Everything that the mind can define as a problem, you see, everything, there is no actual problem. See, but the mind can define many things as a problem. Everything that the mind can define as a problem, God's presence is the solution. You don't need to look anywhere else. Don't need to look anywhere else. And this is when you're truly living. And living in this light, because you always have to be living in this light, but living in this light blunted with the darkness and the cloud of the mind, you see, is not something that we can truly call a life. So if your mind says, I cannot be happy unless I discover my true reality, Nirguna Brahman. Ananta is just talking about the presence. But what about Nirguna Brahman? You can never come to, you can talk about Nirguna Brahman for lifetimes. Is it? But unless you're living in God's light, you can never meet Nirguna Brahman. It is not possible with any other instrument but this light. This is the light of intuition. Sadguru presence itself is the light of intuition. So anything which the mind may conclude that is missing or is a problem is only available here, in the heart. So this is the way of the heart. To rely on the heart, to rely on God's presence, God's light for everything. And why would you want to go back to the mind? It would be good to notice, because that is where the boundary of your faith is drawn by the mind itself. So inquire into that or surrender it at the Satguru's feet. This is the foundation of a true life. Most of our brothers and sisters in this world are not leading a true life. So if you love them, you must first allow yourself to follow God's will. But true love is also to point them to what a true life can be. In your own way. You had a chance to meet God, and you're meeting God in your heart. Is there a brother or a sister who doesn't deserve that same chance? Of course, they are close to it. Most are close to it. So I'm not saying break the door down because we can't, and that may be counterproductive. But have we even knocked gently to check? If we haven't, then either we don't feel that this truly is God that we are discovering. You may feel like it's just a nice spiritual experience. But if you feel that you're truly discovering God, but then you're scared about your self-image or what will they think, or they may reject me, that has nothing to do with you. So it is natural what I'm saying actually, and it will unfold also naturally, but I'm just trying to remove any mental obstacles you may have to it, because as you start living in God's light, the instrument which you've taken yourself to, which you have taken it to be, that instrument you have taken to be your body and your mind, you're coming to its rightful ownership as a vessel for God's light. And it'll happen naturally, of course, as well, where people start coming to you and saying, what has happened to you? Something is different about you. Many times it doesn't work out the way we expect. But many times they could be saying it in a bad way, bad, quote unquote. But when they do notice something is, in their mind, positively changed about you, then allow the heart to speak to them without censoring and judging through your mind. So in this way, the presence that is blessing your life with so much, then others can also have the chance to transform your life, transform their lives in this way. Also, this aspect is important because it gets you over sometimes this whole obsession with me, me, me. Your love broadens in this way. And what love is there without this light? Just a mental love full of need for reciprocation and projection. What love is there without God? It's just specialness and desperation and desire posing as love. So this switching over from the way of the head to the way of the heart, switching over from life on my terms, the egoic terms, to God's terms. From a life of vanity to a life of surrender. As this change starts to happen in your life, you will notice many times that there is fear. There's fear because you had all these plans. You built a nice igloo for yourself. But the appearance of God is like a massive snowstorm for your igloo. Sandcastle you built and a huge wave is coming now. And that is not what you expected because you expected that God will make that igloo better. I mean, make the architecture of the sandcastle nicer. Because people told you that you manage material success, you manage physical success, you manage emotional success, you manage mental success. Now you just need to fit the spiritual success part of it in your box and your life is perfect. But what you're finding is that this is not something that you can put in the box anyway and you can't even see the box anymore. You're starting to see that the box is false. So literally, like these kids say sometimes, you know, on these social platforms, that I live so out of the box that I ask, where is the box? So you're starting to notice that life is really like that. It has always been like that, and the box has only been a figment of our mental thinking and conceptualization. And that can seem a bit scary. Not a bit sometimes, a lot scary. Because can anyone say what is going to happen next? We've never been able to say actually. But now living in God's light, it's completely clear that anything could happen. And that can seem scary. So it was easy lip service for us to say, I surrender it all to God and God can run my life. It's easy for us to say these things. But we sort of had unsaid terms and conditions, asterisk over there. Conditions apply. Don't touch my attachments. Don't touch my fears. So you can drive, but don't go to the overdrive. Yeah. But now, because you are badly stuck, because you are half dozed, Murad can tell us more about what that must be for a patient if they are half anesthetized or half dozed. It's worse. You know, the only way out is full dose. You may feel like you can beat a full retreat at times. Some feel like that. Oh no, I didn't know that this is about giving myself up completely. You see, because in the spiritual marketing that I got, it was about making my life better. I didn't know it's about completely self-sacrificing that which I take myself to be. Nobody makes a poster saying, come to satsang so that you can die to yourself. Everybody makes a poster saying, come, you'll get peace. You worried about money? Are you worried about family? Are you worried about health of body? Come. This is what you are. That's a promise. But true spirituality is what? Only God. Only God. Not God to help me. But if there is a me still here, then how can that me surrender to God and be in service to God? And by the very nature of this world, it is not designed to be attractive. not designed to be attractive. So that fundamentally is this whole game. Now, some of you and many in the world may feel that, but to meet God's presence or God's light is not that straightforward. So all the spiritual practices and love and devotion and singing and all of that is meant to put us in touch with this. And I want to tell you that if you're in this world and you haven't met God, you haven't lived yet, you haven't started living yet, I'm not making a passionate speech or being poetic, very, very literally and very, in a very straightforward plea, I want to tell you that wake up and start living. Wake up and start living, because the life that you have imagined in your head is only going to death. It's only ending up under the ground or on the funeral pyre. Hello, you may feel, especially if you're new to satsang, you may feel that you're not equipped enough to undertake this task. Of meeting God. You may feel, because the world has made it a very far-fetched thing. It happens to very rare people. It made itself to be something which is far-fetched. It's made far-fetched even in spirituality. I've met and I've spoken to a few spiritual masters who are not really talking to their students about meeting God, really. Just talking about some conceptual spirituality and something to make you feel better. This is not true. God is available to us. God is what we are made up of. A little bit of letting go of egotism, letting go of my way, things have to be my way. And you will start to see that God's light is revealing itself to you. It is actually true that if we take one step, then God takes 100. But in our mind, we've blocked it. We made it something, either something that should be done in really old age, or there's no point even, because who's going to ever find God anyway? Even the great sages had so much difficulty in finding God, apparently. So it can feel like this is unachievable. But what are you going to do about the calling in your heart which is saying, come, you will not be satisfied till you meet your creator. What are you going to do about it? And how much material can you drown this calling? And how much ambition, and how much money, and how much muscles, and how much understanding conceptual meaning of things, which is all going to die with you. How will you drown out this calling that something is missing? How about you follow it for a bit and see if it is possible to find an eternal life which is not constricted by birth and death? So what I'm saying in a way is, keep your goals, but just make them 1,000 times bigger. You want to be happy till you're 85 and then die. I'm saying, is it possible for you to live for thousands of years? You want money to make you happy for a few years, whatever years are left of this life. Try and find something which may make you happy eternally. The mind will block you. It will say, that sounds too far-fetched. But what is the alternative? The myth of Sisyphus is the only alternative. Do your daily job, earn your daily bread, live lifelessly for 70, 80, 90, 100 years. Die. I promise you that if you live like that, the mind is one. And if you live with half dosage, the mind is still one, saying, nice try, but see you next time. And I'm going to fight tooth and nail so that that doesn't happen. Let God say to the mind once, nice try, my child, you did well, but this one is mine. God say that about us. Okay, I've been speaking non-stop. Let me end with just one thing, which is that what is all of this, like our mind wants to know what is the practicality in all of this? How can I actually live this? Yeah. So for that, I'm saying you wake up in the morning. You may not remember first thing in the morning. But as soon as you remember, because I'm seeding this with you, you may not even remember it tomorrow morning, but there will be a morning soon. You'll remember this. You see? Wake up in the morning, instead of turning to your mental task list, turn to your heart. Till the presence is not clear, apparent to you, don't leave your bed. What is the worst case scenario? Your family will call you stupid, you miss your work appointments, people will say he's lost it, he's become a sadhu, she's lost it, whatever. Except that it may come your way. Because remember, you sacrifice your life to God. So don't leave your bed, don't pick up your phone, don't do anything at all till you have met God in your heart. Whether it takes prayer to do it, chanting to do it, breathing to do it, just to do it, if it takes half a moment or it takes 2 hours, doesn't it? Meet God in your heart and dedicate the day to God. That itself is a very, very beautiful and auspicious beginning. It's a very beautiful and auspicious beginning where you did not start off in service to your phone or to tasks or your email or whatever it is. You started the day in service to the light within you. Then remain there throughout the day and let all actions just unfold from that. Let all actions unfold from that. And without you using that label, I can tell you your life has already become a satsang. Because that is how satsang is shared. This one just shows up, this instrument just shows up here, waiting for the heart to move this mouth. And there have been a few satsangs in 12 years where on a few days, the heart did not move this mouth, so we just sat inside. It's fine. So if the words of satsang can be shared from this life, then can our life not be lived from there? So just allow this light to move whatever you take yourself to be. If you take yourself to be the universe, then allow the light to move the universe as the light sees fit. If you take yourself to be this body, then allow the light to move this body. And even if that means, like one boy said, I was just standing in front of the shelf, not knowing what I came here for. But even that moment in front of the shelf, being in God's presence is greater than any book you would have picked up from the shelf or whatever you came to the shelf for. So don't let your mind become the judge of what is happening in your life. That part seems scary to all of us. Because the fear is, I was fine with my mind. I wanted God. But what if God completely messes it up? But who is the determinant of a worthy life? And what basis can we determine whether life is a mess or it isn't? Are these avadutas roaming around? And I'm not advocating you chasing any avadutas. But just roaming around with no ambition and no money and just eating what people are giving them. But hopefully and apparently living fully in God's life. Is that a more worthy life? Or is our life of worry and regret and chasing and grasping and then dying, is that a more worthy life? There are many in holy places where we go and we want to sit around them. Why? Because in their presence, our desires will be fulfilled. They're not there for that. They're showing you the way. So whether in the will of God, your life becomes of Janaka or if it becomes of a beggar on the street, you must be open to that. And if you're not open to that, then you must bring that fear itself to God. I'm not saying then take that and become, start to think you're unworthy and you should stop coming to satsang and all that further drama that our mind will do. But see that this is where you draw your line. and then bring that to God and say, this is where I draw my line. So I can sit and become an admirer of Anandamayi, but I don't have the courage in my heart to follow. There's nothing wrong with that. If you bring it to God, there is nothing wrong with it. But if you deny it and you still continue to believe you are something special in your head, then that is an error. You cannot have half surrender. It's all or nothing. So, yes. So, throughout the day, allow this light to unfold. As you get used to living like this. Okay, and then what will happen also is as you allow the light to unfold, at least initially, you will have moments where you notice that you're in your head. You see, you notice it. So, what to do then? And I feel like the diet metaphor, although I've used it often now, still works. So let me mix two of my metaphors. It's like you were in a diet, but you went to the restaurant, and this restaurant, I don't know what it's called now, many of them have now, where they have this conveyor belt. So they have this conveyor belt where the dishes come. And you pick from the conveyor belt, at the end, whatever, based on the color of the dish and how many dishes you have, you get charged. So you went to the conveyor belt, which is the mind, like a conveyor belt, thoughts are coming. These are the dishes. You decided you will live in the way of the heart and not become egotistical or selfish. But you picked up a dish. You ate it. What is our usual operation after this? What should it be? What should it be? It should be that we run out of the restaurant immediately, isn't it? But what is it usually? Yeah, to speak colloquially, it is usually "Acha chalo, ek kha liya hai, toh sabhi kha le." I've taken one, so now I might as well have the 7-course meal. Just like have the main course, have the dessert, have everything. And although in light of it, it's actually pretty potent, this this metaphor is pretty potent. Because this is what we usually do. So when you spot yourself in the middle of eating some Chinese food, all you have to do is run out of the restaurant. And see, return to your heart. Return to God's life. Nothing is lost. Nothing is ever lost. But that does not mean that you continue to indulge in the falseness, in the egotism, in the specialness. Even specialness posing as unworthiness. So the minute you spot it, you run out of the restaurant. That's all. Return to God's light. Allow it to unfold. Another aspect of this has been scary to some of you, which is that I have been saying that if God's presence guides you towards something or guides you to do something, then you must unwaveringly follow. That part has seemed a bit scary. But that's part when it has been applied to others around you, where I said to you that from this presence, if something comes from your heart to tell your friends or your family, and in a way you're sharing from this light, then you must not hesitate. That part all of us have loved. That part all of us have loved. And if we told our best friend and that best friend refused to follow, then we would say, you have to learn how to listen. It's okay. But in the same way, if it came within you that you have to follow, then you have a problem with that. Then you start saying, "My heart, how is the heart speaking in words? Only the mind must use words." But if I was to say to you that those words will be your sharing of satsang with others, you're okay with that. Noticing the double standard. So, the same obedience that maybe one day you will expect those who come to you to have, that we must also have first. This is, and this requires complete faith and surrender. So we look today on the way of insight which shows us our reality, and the way of faith which allows us to have our head bowed down in service to God's light, come what may. And that is truly the way to live. That is the way of the heart. How many of you have a but? Kind of but. The karate but. So, is there a but which does not concern you? Or the false you? I'm waiting for a doubt to come which is actually full of concern for God in all of this. You have a... Now this I want to hear. Go, Marisa. Go. What are you worried about God now?
It's not worry about God. It's just that I'm confused, you know? Like, I live as though, you know, like I'm in the heart, you know, and I allowed, you know, what a job to have, you know, and things that were very scary. But then the level of scariness went level up, you know, and that brought me back. And now I'm scared of that fear again, you know, so I'm stuck a bit there. It's not that I don't want to follow God, but it's just that level of fear was strong.
Yes, yes. And today's contemplation is about this. And we shared as well in terms of the fear will come because you're being introduced not to something that you can include in your way of life. See? But you're being shown a completely transformed way of life. At least inwardly. Externally, you may continue to have your job and all those things, nothing you have to renounce. But you're renouncing the old way completely. And that change can seem too strong for the mind because it wants a comfortable spirituality, a feel-good spirituality, a peaceful spirituality. It never wanted to accept a spirituality which will require 100% faith, maybe 1000% faith. So, if the fear is getting amped up, see if you can find it in your heart to not retreat, but to bring that fear itself and the message of the fear itself to God. And say, I want to follow. I want to live in God's light. But this is where I'm stuck. And God, you know, I want to say from experience, although it's not like a guarantee because the mind loves guarantees, I just want to share an experience that whatever in this life I have brought to God, you. God has never done it my way, but he's always solved it his way. Whatever I've brought to God. And then we can also, in our pride, bring some possible solutions. Never has happened that way. But the way that God finds is so unique. It's so unique. That if we continue to be open and to just look, we will see that it's so astounding. God's ways are so mysterious. They're so beautiful. They're so unexpected. They're so full of grace. But never expect God to dance to our mind's tunes. When the mind can only see, okay, door A and door B, red door and blue door, suddenly, in grace, there's a purple door, which you never saw. So, this is the beauty of this. When you find yourself weak, take that weakness to God. Make it God's to resolve. But don't hastily run back to the mind. Prefer the confusion of the mind, the seeming lack of clarity, prefer that to a mental conclusiveness. This can seem very tough because maybe we started spirituality because of that trouble. We wanted to have clarity of thought. But I'm going to use a crude sounding metaphor. If in your garbage can, the garbage is well arranged or is just thrown about, does it matter? So the limited defining role that the mind plays, which makes the ego out of you and makes us selfish and full of trouble and suffering, all that garbage, like we still in satsang, many of us refer to well-aligned garbage as clarity. We must stop doing that. I prefer badly thrown garbage to nicely arranged garbage. I prefer a mind which you cannot make sense of than a sensible mind. So confusion sounds much better to me than full clarity about being that which you can never be. Being a person which never existed. Don't run from confusion. Accept confusion. Accept a confused mind. If you walked into a playground one day, and there were football players who were playing along with basketball players. And you were just like, what's going on here? What game is this? And then you would leave that playground to find another place. Because nothing made sense in that playground. That playground is preferable to that where you find, oh, everything makes so much sense and it's so clear. Because it is all defining somebody who doesn't exist. So, if all your ideas are about one who doesn't exist, but you are super clear about those ideas, is that better or worse?
Worse.
Or do you just confuse? One day the mind says, I'm so honest. Next day it says, I'm full of lies. Next it says, I'm so good at this. Next moment it says, I'm horrible at this. You see, that kind of hodgepodge is much better because you'll find an alternative mode of knowledge. rather than the arrogance. And I am so like this, and I have always been like this, and I have been like that. You talk to most people, you just get that garbage. You don't need that. Because the entity that they are defining has never been born. Who's honest? Are they talking about the body? Who's spiritual? Are they talking about the body? Who wants freedom? Who wants money in the bank? Not the body. Who's upset with their manager or girlfriend or boyfriend? Not the body. See, so that fake one has never been born. And we spend our entire life catering to that. And when we believe that we are that, then our idea of peace is to have peace in the mind, which means thoughts which are very clear. So if you had a whole science book talking about a sun which never existed, but the book was written very well, of what value is that book? Zero. So our life philosophy is usually like that. And we want it to be better written instead of wanting it to be thrown out. So I would rather have a book which is all chapters messed up, all topics messed up, everything messed up, so you don't rely on it anymore. And you look for something which is better than that, bigger than that. So if you are confused, it is good. Dive in further.
Okay. Good to hear that.
Okay, tell me one more thing. When we speak of clarity, what are we saying? What should be clear?
The heart.
The heart is, when is it not clear?
When I go to the mind.
Okay, this is good. Thank you. Thank you for saying that. But the heart is always clear. It is, we go to the mind, and therefore then we are listening to two voices and we become unclear. I am proposing something astounding to you. In an instant of meeting this intuitive Sadhguru presence in your heart, you know the reality of the self completely and you know the reality of the world completely. The self is known, self-knowledge is apparent, and there is nothing but the self, including the seeming projection of the world. So the nirguna is known, the saguna is known, and all the intricacies of maya are known completely. In an instant of intuitive insight, intuition doesn't take time. It doesn't take working, it doesn't take mechanics. It's the aparoksha. So in the heart, there can never be a lack of clarity. In the head, it is only conclusion, conclusion, confusion, confusion. Today's conclusions are tomorrow's confusions. And that is very good, because then we look for something greater than a mental conclusiveness. So if your head is confused, run back to your heart. You cannot say that because my head is confused, I dug in more into my head. Because that sounds like a nice narrative from the mind itself. I try to live in my heart. The thing has got super amped up and confusing and difficult. So I had to return to my old way. Remember then, that is why surrender comes in. You cannot say, I surrender to God fully, but I will terminate this contract the minute things don't go according to my mind's plan. So this is the moment, okay? Place your bets on the table. And the only bet you can place is your entire life. Either you place it fully, or you don't. But if you don't, then don't talk about surrender. Bring the lack of faith to God. And in that way, we are full of integrity in our spirituality. But if our lips are saying, I'm completely surrendered to you, Master and God and Father, everything, the little bit pinching comes and we're back in it. I know it can seem like I'm asking for a lot, but I really am not. It can seem like he's saying, give up every idea of my life in exchange for a possibility of meeting God. What is the better, what sounds like a better bet? Everything that you took yourself to be and everything that you want to become in exchange for a mere possibility of meeting God. What do you think? Then it takes the entitlement out of our surrender. Otherwise, what happens is we all of us end up surrendering with a great sense of entitlement. Oh, I've surrendered everything to God. Now, nothing. Keep quiet. Doesn't make, give you the right to expect. It's not a business deal. It's not a quid pro quo. It will still happen only with grace. Cannot be done by us, it will be done to us, but for it to be done to us, we have to first empty the vessel.
Father, in my heart I feel trust. Yes. And especially this morning in the contemplation, and it's really beautiful with all my brothers and sisters when they speak up, like it's really powerful. And it's been very helpful for me, and I feel for everybody.
Yes.
I go to the head to say, is this real trust? You know, and when I'm with you in here, like the trust is true, but it hasn't melt like everything until this morning's when you spoke. You know, you really made me feel that a lot of guilt was coming out for like the past year. And well, thanks to Guruji also and to brothers and sisters and to you, I feel this, you know, it was giving a lot of trouble, but it's just like, yeah, God is here. The contemplation was saying just God is here, just I am. You know, and I don't know, I just wanted to share that and to thank you very much to you and to Guruji, and thank you, God, for being here with us.
Thank you, Michelle. But one thing I will tell all of you, I want to tell you one thing. God is not for you. It's not for you. True spirituality is you for God. God is not here to give you a trouble-free life. God is not here to give you a stress-free life. I'm not at all chopping or being harsh. I'm just saying that our goal has to be aligned to service to God instead of how God is making our life better, less confusing, more trusting, more full of peace. If you change the protagonist of the narrative, that itself will go a long way.
Okay, so if I say I'm in service,
yes,
of you, like when offer like my individual self to you, is it lip service, or when is it not lip service?
It's not. Yes, thank you. Thank you for that question. So if you said that I'm surrendered to you, or I offer my life to you, where do you draw that boundary? And you know in your own heart where that boundary is. Take that boundary to God or to the Master's presence itself.
It's a confused boundary. No.
Yes. Whether it is confused, whether it is clear, this is my boundary. And allow all of that to burn. Because the power of your words is very potent. I offer my life to you. Let thy will be done. But what are those areas where we still want my will be done?
Yeah, when I say, I don't want...
And what is the intention behind the offer? Is the intention behind, I offer myself to you fully so that I may be peaceful now forever?
Mm.
That is not a true offer. I offer to you fully that you may use me as you see fit.
That's my heart offering, Father.
Yes.
That's my true heart offering. Just help me to get rid of these boundaries.
Yes, exactly. That is it. That is my true offer for my heart. But help me overcome my disbelief. Sorry. So then we come into the fire of a true spirituality instead of, I don't want any of my children spending like so many years in satsang spirituality, but just having their boundaries nicely hidden away somewhere, the blind spots never coming into focus, and then the mind to win at the end saying, nice try. True spirituality can seem to demand a lot from us. But the gift of the highest, for the gift of the highest, this is no price to pay, it's nothing at all. When you say, all I want is freedom, and I may say, come, we'll talk at this particular time. You may say, no, Father, that is the football final is happening. I'm taking a very simple example. I can't talk to you then. It's the World Cup final. So sometimes it can be in like five of these small things.
Yeah.
So sometimes the mind plays a trick on us and says, but he will say, go to Tiruvannamalai and don't carry any clothes and beg on the street. I'm not saying any of that. Not yet, anyway. I don't want to have a permanent reassurance like that. Then it takes away the fire of what I'm saying. So where do we draw our line? Where do we say, I surrender, but?
But I feel there is some still trust in the mind, of conclusions that the mind is giving. I don't know if it's conclusion or ideas. And
okay, so how it works is that it offers ideas, your belief makes them conclusions.
Yeah. I think so. I don't know. I just have to stay in the heart and not to listen to the mind.
Yes, but the good news is that every moment is a fresh starting point. It doesn't matter how many thoughts you believe till now. If you're empty right now, you're fully empty right now. It's all gone.
True.
See, that is, I'm saying that it's not about a postmortem or a feeling guilty or unworthy. But to spot the tendency now and to drop it. This is very, very simple things. You may say, my life is surrendered to you, Father. I may say, okay, get rid of all prejudice against your brothers and sisters. Don't be prejudiced by religion. Don't be prejudiced by color. Don't be prejudiced by culture. Don't be prejudiced by food habits. That itself will show you some boundaries. Don't make a distinction between a brother or sister for any reason. Especially not for their belief system. Because their only error is the same error that we are doing. It can be like that. Some of those who are here, many times I've been saying, forgive everyone. You may find some boundaries there, and it's important to look at those and to burn them in the fire of satsang. I may even say something simpler, like I may say, do the contemplations. That itself can show us a boundary. Oh no, I don't feel like, oh, I've got too much work today. So bring that to your heart and say, if the one who I call guru or master or father or whatever says, it's important to at least read through the contemplation every day. But we find other reasons to not do it. Or, oh, this one is about forgiveness or humility. This doesn't apply to me. I'm done with this stuff. It's all gone. So this is just these. It doesn't have to be big things. It can be very small things. All I'm saying is that don't quickly jump to the conclusion that you're fully surrendered. If your lips have said that you're fully surrendered, it is good because you have made a claim. Now try to meet that claim and see what stops you. Where is your boundary? Where is the limitation? And bring that into the fire of your own insight. Okay, let's hear from Karuna Mayi. Click the wrong button, just put your hand up again.
Thank you, Father. Today I wasn't able to follow you much.
I want to say something about that. It is that some of us are naturally inclined to the way of faith, and some of us are naturally inclined to the way of insight. So what will happen is because we started today with a different way, which is straight into diving into the highest insight possible, and sometimes those who are not naturally inclined to that way of looking can find it a bit strange to do that. But it's good to just remain as open as possible, and then we get used to it, because both are important.
I feel you're right about it, because somehow even when you presented the two wings of self-realization, I feel maybe more inclined to the way of faith, and maybe this self-inquiry is not something that brings fruit into my being yet, in a way.
Yeah, but you will know as you go along on the way of faith that you will not be able to make a distinction soon, because your faith will override everything. It just override everything and make you so open that you will not be able to even define yourself in this way, because it cannot be that I have so much faith in Father, I have full faith in Father, but I listen to only half of what he says.
I know. And it's not, I didn't listen because
at a point, it is not something that we are doing like on purpose now. Oh, now he's talking about inquiry. It seems like a natural inclination at a point. But truly, important. Both are important. Both the things are important, faith and insight. Insight helps your faith, and faith helps your insight. I'm saying both are equally important, like two chambers of the heart. The way of the heart has both of these.
And even like when I'm in Tiru, and I actually, the first time I went to Tiru back in 2020, I went there because I saw a Ramana Maharshi video, but then I was so drawn to Yogiram Surat Kumar Ashram that I pretty much spent all my time with Madhevaki and in Yogiram Surat Kumar Ashram.
You're frozen.
So I spent most of my time in Yogiram Surat Kumar Ashram, and when I came back, it's always the same. Like I stay a bit in Ramana's presence and in his ashram, but I'm still drawn into this other wing. Somehow.
So this may be a misunderstanding also, that Bhagwan is a representation of the way of intuitive insight and yogiji is a representation of the way of faith. Both are supreme embodiments and beautiful embodiments of both. So it may be that a certain aspect of their expression may be more appealing or less appealing to us presently, but it's not true that it's only about one thing. It is not possible for any sage to be half-hearted in that way. It is not also possible that for any of us that we will have full faith, but insight will not be given to us, or full insight, but faith will not be given to us. It is impossible. So if it is impossible for us, then for a sage, it is just not possible. And these distinctions may be just the expression of the words or the teaching that is available presently. But more importantly, maybe the mind makes these kind of boundaries as well. So, but don't really believe that Bhagwan was only like this and Yogiji was only like that. That would be a disservice to yourself. They won't mind. They won't mind. It would be a disservice to yourself.
Thank you. Now, the reason I put my hand up is I'm very much struggling to, and I try to surrender something, but it's not.
It's not humanly.
What did you say?
It's not going. You surrender it, keeps it. It's like a boomerang.
I thought you said it's not humanly. And, yeah, it almost feels not human.
The boomerang. Just like, oh. I give it to you, Father. <I can't.
laughs> And it's haunting me, and it takes this strong shape of a desire, and I want to do something or to be somewhere, and it doesn't give any space, or it gives space for a second and it comes back again, and you clean it up every second day. But I can't.
What you're basically saying is that you're burning. Yes?
I'm burning. I don't know what I'm doing.
If you're burning, it is good. If you're not burning, it is good.
I think it's out of scope what I'm doing.
Out of scope. Out of syllabus.
Okay, and I feel it's very important to live in the physical presence of the master, so can...
You feel, or you think?
I don't think I think about this too much. Can I give you a practical example? You did something and there was such a strong desire to... I'll share this because it's just something... Yes. You provoked it!
Or someone who says, "Fully, I have full faith in you, Father." I say, "No." You say, "Yes." You can't say, "I will say." But I'm fully surrendered.
No, I fully surrender, but this little aspect. So you said to identify my limits. I have a limit. And it doesn't make any sense to be online with you. Like, and
they don't say even that much. Huh? It doesn't extend even to that much. I was just half jokingly, of course, saying, "I have to say." And I said, "No, you can't say." "No, but I have to." That is the boundaries.
That's my mind. When it has to do something, it has to do something.
Of course it's your mind. Why do you think I'm being choppy? Is this the boundary? My life, everything, Father, my children, my life, my condition, everything is surrendered to you. I have to say this. Father says, "No." But I'm going to. And how will we follow God's will? You need to cater to your belief system this month. How will you follow God's will?
I'm not.
Okay. I take that to God. Say, when my mind becomes so insistent that I know what is right, and this is what it is, and this is what's wrong with me. Because only once you know what is right can you even determine what is wrong. Then if you're still so attached to what you think is right and attached to what you think is wrong, that you insist on following that, come what may, then bring that to God's light, to bring that to your heart's light. This could be a very good example of getting over the mind, of getting over ourselves. Just take this as an example. I know your mind is screaming to say something. Yeah? And it's also hoping right now that I will say, okay, now say it. But suppose we just took this as a good example. Can you see it is from the mind?
I do see it is from the mind.
Now, once you do see it is from the mind, do you have to dance to its tunes? What is
not in emphasis.
What is the magnetism? What is the attraction in these belief systems, in these thoughts?
My freedom. Huh? My freedom.
It will be available in the mind's judgments. Do you feel that one day, in spite of what all the masters, all the sages, and you've been blessed enough to meet so many, I've told you, in spite of all of that, one day the mind will crack the puzzle for you and show you the way to freedom. The thief will give up its own address. The thief will come and give up its own address and say, come catch me.
No.
Then why do you value the mind?
Because it learned from you.
Of course, it will learn everything. It will try to become the spiritual ego. And there is no greater nemesis to me than your spiritual ego. Because it will try to be the version, the spiritual version of your mind in your head. It will say, I know something, but I'm just following what Father said. So it will take everything it hears in satsang. It learns from me, it learns from the masters, and pretend to become the arbiter of right and wrong again. That's why I told you, and sometimes when I don't say things in lion mode, this is what happens. I've told you all that the only way to check on the goodness or badness of something, or the rightness or wrongness of something, the truth and false of something, is where it is coming from. If it is coming from the heart, then it is from God. If it is from the mind, it is from the ego. Even if it sounds super spiritual. So does your heart now have to dance to your spiritual mind?
No.
You spot this now and throw it away. Because this can become lifetime's worth of trouble. When your mind starts posing as if it knows the truth from a spiritual standpoint, the end of that journey is only towards spiritual arrogance, spiritual pride, which is the worst kind of spiritual ego. There's no innocence lost as it is lost in spiritual ego. It's the worst sort of loss of innocence. And I won't wish it on an enemy, let alone my children. If you know things from the spiritual aspect of your mind, you have to return to a full humility. Humility quickly, there's no time to waste. Because this one will grab you and make you super special so fast. Be careful of the spiritual mind more than anything else. Just keep smelling for the fragrance. Is it fragrant? If it is fragrant, follow it.
Sorry, if it's
fragrant. If it has the fragrance of love, if it has the fragrance of your heart, only then follow.
Okay.
So tell me now, if it is fragrant and coming from your heart, tell me that now. And also notice that when you start to use words like I feel, but actually what you mean is I think or I know, then it is could also be like a spiritual camouflage to the mind. Unless you truly feel intuitively, then you need to say, I feel. But if you just say, I feel, but it's actually, I know or I think. So, the problem you now is only your knowledge. Be troubled without knowledge, let me see. Don't suffer. You say that you're attracted to the way of faith. In the way of faith, you don't have to know anything. If you're following the way of faith and you're just knowing stuff.
I don't know anything, but I feel I'm torn apart between the two of you somehow.
With that same old story.
I wanted to start that time in the same place as a month and a half ago.
The mind that divides. Mind that divides.
And I. I can't explain
about,
what happened.
Is this God for me or me for God? I am conflicted about who to follow,
not to follow, because I follow.
Or to lead.
I follow one and the same.
Then who can I lead?
I can't lead any of you. But where to live?
To leave, I can tell you, which is the mind. I can tell you where not to live, which is your head. From the physical location of where you live is not important.
More or less, I don't know.
Okay, send me a message, we'll have a look.
Thank you.
Let's go to the last one, and then there's a bit of some Christmas singing is happening, or something is happening. I don't know what it is.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Love you.
Love you too. Let's go to Anuj Jain Amrita.
Namaste, Father.
Namaste, my dear. Where have you kids been missing?
Oh, other. It's been a little hectic from past few months. Traveling and... But it's all being very good with all ups and downs, like your ups and downs. So, but it's, there's a realization that there's only God's way. I mean, it's tired of this way now. It's like, you know, exhausted completely of this way. Invariably, it moves here. But... it's the redundancy of it. It's kind of, it's seen very clearly. I mean, it's not that interest is gone. The juice has definitely become quite less, but still, old habits play and a lot of mind attacks also happen at times. And for me also, I mean, it just takes away on my body, but somewhere in everything, it's clearly seen that this is not me. So that's I feel it's a lot of your blessing, which is
very good. But
all good. It's all for good. Good.
This is very good.
At least now the but is not that but. When the but also comes, it's known that it's all for good. It's all. It's only getting better day by day.
Very.
Thank you so much, Father. I really want to come to you.
Come like last time I left.
Yeah. No, this time we feel like we want to come and just stay with you only. Like, in the building only. We want to come and...
We'll get to your house.
Be there with you.
I'll be very happy. If this can happen, I'm very happy.
I mean, this time decided, like, next time we're going, like, we have to be with you. The call is fast.
No, I felt you were saying you want to leave permanently. Okay. Got my hopes up for a moment.
Whatever. However, whatever. Your wish.
Very good. with all my love.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, my dear. Love you.
Lots of love, Father. Love you so much.
So what is happening? Something is happening, or what's the?
You want Christmas songs, is it?
No, what is it? Don't worry.
Spanish an old song. I think everybody's heard it. It's by U2, but it's actually a gospel song. So it's about Christmas coming up.
Yes.
It's about being lost and finally being found. Highest mountain, I can run through the fields, only to be with you, only to be with you. I have run, I have grown, I have scaled these city walls, these city walls. Thank you.
I'm still running. You broke the bonds and broke the chains, carried the cross off my shame, off my shame. You know I believe it. Now I finally have found what I was looking for.
Quite a father son duo we have. Quite a father son duo, father daughter duo. Yeah.
Okay, sing the next
one. Son is on the
line.
Too much.
Daughter is something else.
Okay, next one is by Ajit Kaur. Does anybody listen to the music? Yeah. It's called Akal for the Timeless One. Huh? It will come to you. She's forgotten it already. Just that. I'll start.
Mother, I feel you under my feet. Father, I hear you, your heartbeat within me. My spirit cries free. Carry me Thank you.
It's a mix of Spanish and English. Any people who speak Spanish? It's okay. Forgive my accent.
Online,
but you can join in.
Era mi cuerpo, agua mi sangre, aire mi aliento, fuego mi espíritu. Era mi cuerpo, agua mi sangre, aire mi aliento, fuego mi espíritu. Earth is my body. Water is my blood, air is my breath, fire is my spirit, earth is my body, water is my blood, air is my breath, fire is my spirit. Hey, hey, mamacita. Hey, hey, mamacita, hey, hey,
to the heart, wild and unknown. Blessed and gracious is where we belong. Family, one tribe, can we all get along? Look to the mountain, the stars and the trees. Look to the mountain, the birds and the bees. We come to the sun, our roots go down deep. Surface beyond our belief. Look at them home, children, don't be afraid. Life is a teacher, so don't run away. Stay wild and free, close your hands and pray. This is the moment, there's only today. Hey, mamacita, show us the way. We no longer run from the shadows of pain. We are alive, we are awake. This is the open and this is our way. Era mi cuerpo, agua mi sangre, aire mi aliento, fuego mi espíritu. Earth is my body, water is my blood, air is my breath, fire is my spirit. Hey, hey, mamacita.
I don't know how long that goes on, but we can do it now after party.
All my love, all my blessings, and may all of you have a wonderful Christmas and with the love of Jesus in your hearts. The blessings of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Thank you. Thank you. So much gratitude from all of us. Sadhguru Shri Maji Baba ki
Jai.
Guru Kripa ke liye. So that was Narain and Advaita.